Thanks. to me to watch him fight so hard, and I almost feel like he's fighting by himself. But I believe once Bruce gets to Congress, he would have a real friend in the White House. Georgia, now, Georgia, listen, I'm from South Carolina, and in South Carolina, listen, we here support Bruce LeVell. And I've had a wonderful opportunity to labor with him, and through thick and through thin. Who you see publicly is who he is privately. And I believe without a shadow of a doubt, he's going to help Donald Trump, he's going to help our president, he's going to help push bills through, he's going to make sure the interests of this district be heard. He is not going to forget, because he's kind of a person that even though all stones are thrown against him, he's going to take those stones and he's going to turn into something positive, and he's still going to fight, fight, and fight to make sure your issues are being heard in the White House, in Capitol Ground. But listen, I'm going to pray, and I'm thankful to pray, because Bruce LeVell believes in the name of Jesus Christ. He is a strong believer. And I don't know about you, but aren't we tired of all of the crooks and the criminals that are in Washington, D.C.? Matter of fact, our president said like this, we're going to drain the swamp. And I believe Bruce is going to help us drain the swamp by making sure that there are real congressmen, there are real politicians who are after the heart of the American people. And and Bruce is one of those people that has the heart for America, that has a heart for Americans. And I know without a shadow of a doubt, which is why Corey Lewandowski is in the room tonight. Corey Lewandowski is in the room tonight. And that speaks volumes. That just shows you the kind of a person Bruce is. For Bruce to be able to pick up the phone and say, listen, I want you to come to Georgia. And I love Georgia. Georgia is a neighboring of South Carolina. I've been in Georgia so long, I'm practically part of the Peanut Clan, I tell you. I'm half Georgia, half South Carolina blood. Matter of fact, I lived in Atlanta for 7 years. And so, you know, I know we are neighbors. We are family. And I believe that there's family members that are here who are ready to say, listen, we're going to fight this racism that's dividing our country. We are Americans. We're tired of being divided by our colors, but we're going to be united by the red, the white, and the blue of America. And we are proud to be Americans. Bruce symbolizes that damn thing. It's more to him than just the color of his skin. No, Bruce is a friend. He's a family man. He's a businessman. And he loves people. And I've only known him for a short time, but we've become very close friends. Midnight conversations. He's the kind of person that I can pick up the phone and call him, and he'll pick up the phone. You know, some people become too famous and too important, they forget you when they become too famous. Bruce is not one of those type of people. And I know there's so many of his friends that are here today that has known Bruce for a long time. And that's why you're here, to show your support. I'm going to pray. And I'm going to lift my heart to Jesus Christ. And I want you to open it, to open your hearts and close your eyes. Because we're going to set this thing up right. Because I believe God is blessing it right now. And you wouldn't be here if you weren't supporting Bruce LeVell. We need more people in Congress that will not create race, color, agenda bills, but agendas and bills that are designed not for a particular race, but for the human race. And that's me and you, because we all bleed red. And I don't know about you, but Bruce bleeds red, white, and blue. And I believe that you do too. Let us pray together. Father God, in the name of Jesus, Lord, I thank you. I thank you so much for the life of Bruce LeVell. I thank you for the friend that he is. I thank you for the support that is here today. I thank you, oh God, even now all needs are going to be met. I think for that, regardless of what people might say, I believe that when there's a force that is starting, there's a ball that's starting, that the echo is going out further, that people are going to continue to support, people are going to grow, people want to jump on board. I thank you, God, that all needs will be met. I thank that all the new staff members that are coming. I thank you for the raising of funds that are going to go to support to make sure that our man becomes the next U.S. congressman of this district. I thank you, God, that you're positioning him. He is made for this. He was built for this. And you called him to it. Now bless every person under the sound of my voice that they too receive whatever it is that you're asking them. That we be a house united and not a house divided. That we will remove and eliminate the spirit of racism. But when we divide and we be unified under the red, white, and blue of America. I'm proud to be a Christian. I'm proud to be a husband. I'm proud to be an American. And I believe Bruce has that same spirit. He's going to take to the House. He's going to take to Congress. And he's going to represent this district. In your precious name, if you believe, if you agree, shout amen.
Amen.
God bless you all. Thank you all so much.
I would like for the former mayor of Dunwoody, Mike Davis, to please come to the microphone and lead us in the pledge.
Hey, Mike. And before I get started, let's remember, true Americans say the Pledge of Allegiance with gusto, and definitely true Republicans do, right? So let's say it with gusto. Ready?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic.
And I have no doubt in my mind that Brooms will fight and be loyal to the 6th District just as hard as he fought and was loyal to our great president, Donald Trump. Bruce was with Donald Trump when nobody thought he had a chance, as was Corey. They were with Donald Trump when people laughed, when people did not take his candidacy seriously, when he was under attack. They laughed. Bruce was with him working to elect Donald Trump. I remember calling Bruce election day. I was actually in Tampa watching the election returns in Florida. Bruce told me, he said, "We got this. Don't worry. We got this." He was very confident. This was even before the polls closed. He was that confident. The voters of the 6th District need to elect a congressman that is friends with the President of the United States. If you love Tom Price, you will love Bruce LeVell. Another reason that you should, everything I've said, if that's not reason enough for you to support Bruce LeVell, I'm gonna give you another very good reason. Sharon, would you stand up? For congressman of the 6th District. As I said, if you're a Trump supporter, you need to be backing Bruce. You need to be backing someone that will be loyal to our president, someone that will work side by side and hand in hand with our president. You need to support Bruce LeVell. And if you're in this room and you're from another county, give money to his campaign. Volunteer to help him. I can promise you, Bruce will surprise a lot of the political pundits on election day. And I'm very pleased to call him a friend. Thank you. Our next speaker needs no introduction. He is a longtime elected official in Georgia. He is also someone that is a strong fighter and fights for what he believes in, just like Bruce. He was one of the first elected officials in Georgia to actually come out and endorse Donald Trump. He is a great friend, and he is a fantastic singer as well. If you've never heard Bubba McDonald sing God Bless America or the national anthem, you need to go to YouTube, you need to hear him sing. He traveled around with his RV all over the state, all over the Southeast, campaigning for our great president, Donald Trump. It is my pleasure to introduce you to Lauren Bubba McDonald. He is on the Georgia PSC, and he is also a fighter. Bubba?
Thank you, Lord, for David Dooley and the pledge.
And so I didn't have to follow past the Burns. I was just totally taken back when he didn't ask for an offering right before. The way he was going, I'm sure it was coming that way. Well, what do you say? I don't live in the district. I don't vote in the district. I'm a mountain man up in Northeast Georgia corner. But I've been a bold person. Y'all have read the story in the good book. Talks about wise men following a star. All the trepidation that they went through to get to where they were going, but they were following the star. That's what they were looking at. Did not really know what was on the other end of it, but they followed the star. Going back to town when December 2015, January 2016, that's when I met Bruce. Yes, I was the first and only statewide elected official to endorse Donald Trump for many, many months. before everybody saw the star and the come-alongs came along. And but Bruce was there with several, many, and you could count really on your hand. The loyalties that were out there doing their thing. And what does it say about, I was talking with my deplorable wife, Shelley. Because in the fall of 16, we were making the rounds, and I want to introduce my wife, Bruce, as Mr. Deplorable. And proudly so she was. But what we found in the time passing through that period when there were others of the numbers that started dropping out and people started making changes and everything, some of those were still solid, staying right down the line, and one of them was Bruce. And I know several of the other candidates in this office, for this office, and they're friends of mine, and I respect them very much. I've been in campaigns with them, and like that, they've been supporters of mine in my elections at the Public Service Commission over the years. But I'm here to tell you that you already know that there's a solid rock amongst us. And that solid rock hitches and stays hitched. Stays hitched for his beliefs, stays hitched for his future, stays hitched for the respect for the people that he will be called upon to take care of. And the other side of it is in every organization, whether it's a monopoly utility, whether it's a jewelry business or whatever, there's got to be a project manager and a CEO. And Bruce understands and has demonstrated religiously last year about his loyalty to the now CEO of America, Donald Trump. And I know that if Bruce is fortunate to have the support of the people of the 6th District, that his loyalty will be there for the people of the 6th, but it's also his loyalty will show up for it as he has in the past to respond to the President of this United States of America, which we're all so proud of. It's a long haul. No race is easy. The roads are very difficult and rocky and turbulent sometimes, but you know, the goals are achievable. And when the success is done, everything, we're all together and we all have one common cause. And I didn't plan to do this, did you? But while the storm clouds gather, far across the sea, let us pledge allegiance to this land that's free. Let us all be grateful to this land so fair as we lift our voices in a solemn prayer. God bless America, land that I love. Stand beside her and guide her through the night with a light from above, from the mountains to the prairies, to the oceans white with foam. God bless America, my home, sweet home. God bless America, my home, sweet
to help elect Bruce LeVell and send a friend of Donald Trump's to Congress. God knows with what transpired next week, he's going to need someone that will fight for him and his agenda. Our next speaker needs no introduction. He is Corey Lewandowski. And one of the things that he did that we will always be grateful for is that he made the strategic decision and had the foresight to let Donald Trump be Donald Trump. And I fully believe had it not been for some of the things and strategic decisions that Corey made, Donald Trump would not be president. He made that very, so I want everyone to give a round of applause. No matter what Donald Trump said or did, it did not stick to him because people wanted someone with a fresh perspective. Corey's been on CNN, and I don't want to hear booze because like CNN had Corey on there. He's also been on Fox News, and it is an honor to have him here, and I fully believe it's because of Corey. We have Donald Trump as President of the United States. Let's give him a nice cordial welcome.
It was really nice. Thank you. Thank you very much. You know, let me say, you come across a lot of people when you run a presidential campaign. And you come across people who pretend to be your friends. Come across people who say they were there from day one. You come across people who picked up the winning lottery ticket the day after you won the election and said that they were all with that in their hand. You come across people you can trust and you want to stand next to. What I learned in this presidential campaign is there's very few people when times get tough that you rely on that would be there for you, not because they wanted something, because it was the right thing to do. This is my first trip, I'll tell you, the first trip I have taken since the president has been elected or since I've left the campaign on behalf of any candidate for office anywhere. And the reason for that is I know a winner when I see one. I saw one with Donald Trump the day I walked into his office and he told me he wanted to be the president of the United States when nobody told me he could do it, and he couldn't run, and he couldn't win, and he'd never file his forms, and he'd never be successful. And the field was too big and too broad and no one was going to take him seriously. We went through all of that. And now I know a winner when I'm in Georgia. And I'm here for Bruce for one reason. Because Donald Trump needs a friend in Congress. Because when it comes to Congress, there's a lot of people there who say, I was with you, Mr. President, when we know they weren't. There's a lot of people who say, Mr. President, I'm here to support your agenda, but guess what, I can't help you on this one. There's a lot of people who say, hey, I want to put the country in the right direction, but on my terms and not what you ran on, Mr. President. Because what the president ran on was reforming health care, repealing and replacing Obamacare, cutting taxes, making sure that the average American has more money in their pocket, reducing trade deficits. We've got $20 trillion in deficit right now, and our numbers continue to go through the roof. If the president doesn't have people of core convictions in Congress that are going to support his agenda, which is the agenda he ran on, and he's not going to be successful. And what we know and what we saw last week was there are some Republicans who supported the president's agenda and some who didn't. We know that we'll never get any of the Democrats. It doesn't matter if the most perfect bill in the history of, you know, Alexander Hamilton himself could come write the bill, or George Washington himself, they wouldn't get a Democrat to support it. Congress has been fundamentally broken for 30 years. Republicans and Democrats alike have gone there and lied to you. They told you they're going to fix it, they didn't do it. And for the first time in my lifetime, we now have a candidate who sits in the Oval Office, who is not beholden to 30 years of Washington dogma, that is not stuck on being bought and paid for by the Washington special interests and their political action committees, that takes a businessman's perspective to the Oval Office, that's going to fundamentally change Washington, D.C. And what you have in front of you tonight, you have a candidate who has a business background, a person who understands what it's like to make a payroll, not live off the government. A person who understands that the government can't continue to spend more than they make. Bruce understands this. Bruce understands what it's like to have to go start a business and run a business and be successful. The ups and the downs and what the government's punitive action can do against small businesses, whether it's the Department of Labor or the EPA, or all these other government agencies that have run amok against our citizens. It's time to have people in Congress who understand that they're given a privilege of going to Congress to serve their people, but the power is derived from the people. What I think we need in Washington, D.C., is something brand new. Like Donald Trump has said and campaigned on congressional term limits, and people say, well, term limits are when you go to the ballot box, but the problem is, the power of the incumbency is so strong and so powerful, that most of these people get in there, they leave in pine boxes, because it's the greatest job they'll ever have. Congress wasn't designed to go there and spend 20, 30, 40, 50 years living off the government. It's supposed to be a citizen legislature where people go and they do their job for a period of time, they go back to their districts, and they go back to the job they had before. And they try and make a change. That's what Bruce wants to do. Let's go to Washington to carry forward the change which the president has brought there. And the only way to do that is to defy the odds. Look, we ran a campaign that was an outsider's campaign, which was a campaign where, you know, we didn't embrace the Republican establishment because we weren't the Republican establishment. We ran against governors and senators and former elected officials and you know, a few business executives. They all told us, you know what, we weren't good enough, smart enough, and we couldn't move forward. We didn't have the best campaign. We didn't have the most talented campaign team. But one by one by one, all those candidates in the primary fell by the wayside because they had the wrong message. Their message was, I'm from Washington, I can fix it. We don't need that anymore. Those days are over. And I think what we've seen is that the American people have decided to embrace change. Bruce is that change. Georgia's going to have a very unique opportunity here very shortly. Early voting has already started. Special elections are very, very difficult because the turnout is exceptionally low. You have an extremely divided field in this particular race, which tells you that the ability to get a small number of votes is more important than ever. You're here. You've taken time out of your day, out of your finances to support this campaign, but it's not enough. If you haven't already voted, you have to start. You have to go vote. You have to tell your neighbors and bring them along. Because early voting is so critical. What I've been told is that the Democrats' early voting numbers are through the roof already. Right? They are engaged. The Democrats are fully engaged to do anything they can to stop the Trump agenda. They will do anything. They will lie, they will cheat, they will steal, they will do anything they can because they are so desperate right now. And what we know is our only ability to move our agenda forward, which is smaller government, lower taxes, less regulation, no more punitive action against small businesses, giving the resources to the small businesses to grow, helping small business owners go from a 1 to 2 and 5 person company to a 10 and 20 and 50 person company, repeal and replace Obamacare. The only way that happens is if we put people in Congress who understand what it's like to be a small business owner or a business owner because they met that payroll. And that's what Bruce brings. Look, career politicians are perfectly fine people, but they've never solved anything. This is the problem that you're faced with. And that's not a disparaging or pejorative comment against any one candidate who's in this race or may not be in this race. I don't believe in career politicians. I support a candidate who hadn't run for office until he was 69 years old. You know what they said when we ran against Jeb Bush? Well, he's a little rusty. I hadn't run in about 8 years. Just my dad hadn't run in 69, he's really rusty, except we would kill him, right? That's the difference. So, look, it's really, really a privilege for me to come down here. And while I'm honored by the opportunity to come, and maybe I have this crazy accent so you guys can't really understand what I'm saying right now, the real thing is, I wouldn't be here if it wasn't for Bruce. On good times in this campaign, and bad times in this campaign, when we set up the Diversity Coalition, Bruce's wife came up to New York with us. When we needed a surrogate to go on television, to combat these egregious accusations that the president is a racist, when we wanted someone who knew, because they had private conversations with Donald Trump, what the man was like, as opposed to the public persona, we never had to call Bruce more than once to go on TV. He was always a steadfast supporter, always there telling the truth when the mainstream media wanted to portray candidate Trump as something that he wasn't. It's a hard thing to do, particularly when you get a lot of arrows and you get a lot of people accusing you of things now because you've put your name and your reputation in front of the American people, in front of the media, and then you're accused of things which aren't very helpful to you or your family or your business when you're a small business owner. But every single time Bruce was asked, and many times when he wasn't asked, and many times when We didn't give him the talking points to go on television. He went on TV and defended the president, or talked about the president, talked about his agenda, supported his agenda. And every time we asked Bruce to come to a rally, he'd be at that rally, and he'd make sure the rally was perfect. And every time we came to Georgia, he was there. He was a friend from the beginning of the campaign. And I can tell you, when we started the campaign, we didn't have a lot of friends. So it's amazing, as we get closer to the end, we get more and more friends. I mean, a lot of friends. It's amazing, right? It's a lot of friends. It's like 90% of them want a job, which is kind of crazy, right? But they all tell me they were there from day one. But look, I know the truth, because I was the person who turned the lights on the building when we started this project. And I know who was there and who wasn't there. Bruce was there. And if I can ask you one thing, ask you to not only vote for Bruce, because it's very important for me that he shows up in Congress and represents the values that he brings in his family and small business, and to represent Georgia's 6th District. It's very important. But you need to bring in friends. You have to understand, races are hard. They're hard on families, and they're hard on friends. But it's the individuals who do the extra step. You know, Donald Trump campaigned in 4 time zones and did 5 different rallies leading up to Election Day while Hillary Clinton was taking a nap. It makes a difference. Every campaign event makes a difference. And if the last event that we did in the state of Michigan didn't occur at 1 o'clock in the morning, I don't know if Donald Trump would have won Michigan that day. He won by the smallest of margins. Every event makes a difference. It is really hard. You've got a special election where turnout's going to be really low. You have to double down. You need to bring your friends out, your family out. You have to explain to them what is truly at stake in this election. And what's at stake is, do we want to continue to move the country in the right direction? For the first time, if you can believe this, since 2009, a public poll says the country's actually going in the right direction. Think of that. We need a Congress which is going to move in the right direction. Congress is going to support the president's agenda. And we're going to have that Congress, and Bruce LeVell is there to make sure that we can support the president's agenda. So I ask you, I beg you, I implore you, not only vote for Bruce LeVell, help him financially, tell your friends, make sure they vote, vote early, make sure that they understand when this election is coming. Special elections are so difficult. There will be people who have more money, happen to us. Almost every candidate in the race had more money than we had in the race. We ran it lean and efficient, like a business operation would be. When I walked in tonight, I saw Bruce's team was lean and efficient, on point everywhere we go. That's what we expect in our campaign. That's what I see in this campaign. So I ask you, go out, get your friends, remind them Election Day is coming. Vote early, vote absentee, whatever it may be. But please, please, please support Bruce LeVell, because we need your Congress. Thank you very much.
I think we can do better than that. Let's let Courtney know. Courtney, we appreciate you being here.
Thank you.
Tonight, we are here because of Bruce LeVell. And because of the fact Donald Trump needs somebody in Congress that is willing to fight for his agenda. His agenda is what the people were drawn to. Voters in 2016 sent a very, very loud message to our nation. They sent a loud message to Congress. Sometimes, from what I've seen over the past few weeks, I think there are a few that are tone deaf to the message that was sent. Bruce will advance President Trump's agenda. He will be a hard worker for the people of the 6th District. He will work just as hard and be just as loyal to voters of the 6th District as he was to our President of the United States. Bruce will give you a little bit of background. He's the managing partner of Dunwoody Diamonds USA and LeVell Properties LLC. He was the former chairman of the Gwinnett Republican Party, which he did a phenomenal job, by the way, because I live in Gwinnett, and he raised a ton of money. He was tapped to serve as the executive director director of President Donald Trump's National Diversity Coalition during the 2016 campaign. He was honored to be a Trump campaign top media surrogate for national news and a national delegate for Trump at the 2016 National Convention. Let's give a big round of applause to the man of the hour, Bruce LeVell.
Where I came from.
I was born in right outside of a military base in Fort Lewis, and my dad was in the service. He's a retired sergeant major. He did two tours of Vietnam, and some of us remember how that was as a child. Some of us remember what it was like in that era. But my background is, my mother had my sister who's 4 years older than me, and she had some extreme complications. She almost died having her. And, you know, it was a rough time back then, 1961 at the time. But when she was going to the doctor, she would pass by this facility. And this facility is a place where they kept children. Back then they called them orphanages. Now they call them group homes and all types of little fancy names, but essentially back then it was called an orphanage. And so she would drive by this facility, and she said one day the Lord told her to just pull in there. And she pulled in there, and she walked in, and she walked through this little room, and there was a big glass door, and it had little lines and stuff. And she looked down there, and she said, "Who's that little guy over there?" And so the nurses, the people that worked at the facility went and picked up the little boy, brought him up front, and came up to the front, and she picked him up and said, "Well, how do I take this little boy home?" And so I was adopted. My mother picked me up out of that orphanage. And back then, you know, my biological mom was German, and my dad was African American. And y'all know back in those days, you know, it was really rough on mulatto kids. You know, we usually got put up for homes, but I will tell you, this is very interesting, and you'll know where I stand on this part, is that we were the most highly aborted children. Because we weren't mixed, we weren't white enough, we weren't black enough, but we were aborted the fastest. And my mother always told me that I was a chosen child. I never figured out what she meant. Chosen, you're talking about, it sounds like some Obi-Wan Kenobi stuff. You know? And I often remember it if she would have not stopped in where I would be today. I don't think I would ever met beautiful people in this room. But what it taught me, it gave me a heart for people. And it gave me a heart for reconciliation, multicultural. And then here I am running the largest diversity coalition in the history of the United States for a 70-year-old white guy from New York. Really cool? No, that's really. National Diversity Coalition for Trump, we're over 1 million+. Manchin's here, Haitian Americans for Trump, Vivian Childs back there, beautiful sisters for Trump. Where's Carlos? Carlos Lamon? He left early. Mexican Americans for Trump. Kevin Doe? Vietnamese Americans for Trump. There he is right there, guys. Yeah. Michael Abramson? Jewish Americans for Trump. Right here. Am I missing some more coalition members in here? I know. We got somebody from the Mountains. That's right. But you know, and you know, see that right there tells you the heart and the passion I have for people. And I love people, I love their hearts, all different shades and sizes, beautiful people. And that's my gift. I'm a very good negotiator. The reason why I'm a negotiator, and I always said the key to being success and being a negotiator is loving people. Think about it. No matter what religion you are, Jew, Christian, Muslim, it don't matter. The heart. And that's a very powerful tool that my mom taught me. And that God blessed me with. And that's a really, it just boils inside of me. And I think, when I think back during the campaign, when, you know, I've done every media hit from, you can imagine, CNN, Fox, Al Jazeera, Turkish News, BBC, NBC, ABC. You know, every question that I was asked was like, you know, President Trump is a racist, President is a racist. That hurts. Because, you know, especially, because I know what racism is, trust me. Believe me, I do. And Donald Trump is not like that, is he, Corey? No way. No way. So that journey taught me a lot. And let me tell you, when, you know, for a guy like me to serve as your congressman, if I'm not battle tested, I don't know what is. I mean, you think about it. You think about the journey. You think about all the media. I literally put my whole entire life, my whole person on national TV. I mean, everyone knows everything about me. Just Google me. There's no secrets. Lord knows I've been vetted, because you don't get on that plane with Secret Service with some drama. I can tell you that right now. You know, a
excuse me, we need to have a conversation. So, I know I'm qualified, ladies and gentlemen. You know, I didn't really plan to run for Congress, and I'm going to tell you why I am running. There's many reasons. One of the biggest reasons was when I saw the candidates lining up, I know who never Trump was, and I know who was against the president, I knew who was and who wasn't. And the candidates in this field, except for one, Amy Kramer, none of them would support the president. I begged and pleaded. Corey will talk about this in the car on the way over. Even when he became the nominee and I was a national delegate, I pleaded with all the Republicans, please, please, come on, come on. They sat on their hands, didn't they, Corey? They sat on their hands. And they're still sitting on it. They're pretending. So I said, you know what? With all these great initiatives, the president wants to implement a $1 trillion infrastructure program. Atlanta has the worst traffic in the nation. I'm the only candidate talking about transportation. Isn't that right, Mayor Mike Davis?
That's right.
I'm the only one. Everyone's talking about, I want less government overreach. Oh, the same old, same old. You know, Avita King. Hello, Avita King. Just walking in. There she is. Martin Luther King's niece right here. Say hello. My spiritual advisor. I love when she calls me randomly, like, come on, brother, let's pray. Be like, 1, 12, 11 at night. Okay, let's do it. No, no, that's serious. I really mean that. Those prayers really help. It keeps me fueled. It keeps me motivated. Thank you, Ms. King, for those prayers. I really appreciate it. She does a lot. She's like, she got the Fox contract now. But, you know,
we have sued it.
But, you know, it's I looked around the other candidates and I said, you know, they don't have a best interest to help. And, you know, one thing of value that I do bring is the fact, like Corey says, I do know the president well. I'll just see him next week. I'm going to go see him. My daughter works in the West Wing with Spicer, Leah LeVell. She started with the coalition also for college Republican, young Republicans for Trump. She started there and then went to the RNC and then went to work in the West Wing. What a blessing for a dad. Amen. Thank you. Amen. But, you know, one thing about being on that trail, I got to meet some incredible people, you know, like Corey and Nick Scavino, Michael Glassman, Kellyanne Conway, Sarah Huckabee, you know, Secretary Kale, she's over at the transportation, Steve Bannon, Jared Kushner, Eric Trump, Ivanka Trump, Ivanka was with my wife, you know, the whole family, and they treated me like a family member. I really got to have some great relationships during the campaign. You really find out who your real friends are when things are really tough. Think about it, guys. It was really tough during the campaign. And, you know, I said, you know, I could literally take this relationship as a United States Congressman, not just a Georgia 6 Congressman, but a United States Congressman. That's what it says, U.S. Congressman. That's a heavy lift. It's also a heavy lift to say, whatever that we need that we could bring back to Georgia, I guarantee you there's no better negotiator than me in that ballot, the people are running for. I guarantee you that. There's no one. Nobody. Because the president, he all knows who we're all talking mess and hate and all. They know. Can't hide. So why not leverage that? Why not leverage that relationship? Think about it, guys. Leverage that relationship. You know, we were blessed in Atlanta. We have such a great growth. We have the largest airport in the world. As of February 25th, we have the worst traffic corridor in the nation. Y'all know that? 400-285. Number one, the worst. Whether you like light rail, heavy rail, extend MARTA, we don't want to extend MARTA, whatever. But at the end of the day, who will have a better play to try to fight to bring your tax dollars back to this district than me?
Nobody.
Not really. It's common sense, and here's the best part about this. One thing that really attracted me about supporting President Trump was this right here, Corey, you remember this. Not beholding to special interests. Okay? Watch this. Not getting involved in PACs. And you saw him tweet about that one PAC that went and boogered up Dr. Price's deal in the House. We'll get to that in a second. And I was like, oh my God, that's so refreshing. A candidate that will not get in bed with special interest groups. That means he has no favors. Ladies and gentlemen, wait till we finish our appointments for ambassadors, right, Corey? You know, the president doesn't owe anybody anything. They don't owe him. He's free to choose the best qualified. All the cabinet members, and all that, that was, there was no pay to play. You know how refreshing that is for our democracy, for our republic? Think about it. Historically, Democrats and Republicans have always, it's always who raised the most money, who had the kickback, what lobbyists made the deal in order to get those appointments. Think about it. Think about how refreshing that is. Imagine a United States congressman, right here, that had disemboweled in writing, I will not accept any PAC money or any PAC support, no lobby money, no nothing. Right, Mayor Mike?
Right.
Yeah. That's why it's hard, guys. I remember Pat called me right after the race. I shared with Mayor Davis, and you know, I said, "Listen, I don't want to be involved, man. Just leave me out." Well, they will run against you. See what I mean? And they're getting involved in the race right now. John Ossoff, that's a pack. Club Grove. What do you say, Dan? What do you call it again? What's that pack up there?
Club for Grove.
Club for Grove. The one the president hates is already jumped in the race. Going against another Republican, getting in bed with another Republican. All you gotta do is disavow it, right? All you gotta do is send out a press statement to the press. I disavow this. That's all you have to say. They won't do it, you know why? They want the money, Alice. That's right. It's hard, but let me tell you something. Nobody owns Bruce LeVell except Jesus. You know, they just had a poll, and they polled in East Cobb, 420 votes, and they're trying to push back the Trump guy. Like, we don't want Bruce in here. I mean, seriously, think about it. They don't want him. Not really. But they don't want someone that can go up there where they can't have a connection to in terms of access. Access meaning pay to play. There's a candidate right now taking lobby fundraisers right now as we speak. Right now, as we speak, taking lobby money. Because that all of a sudden, the lobbyists think they're their friends, and now they're like, hey, you're my best friend now. Only because they need access. Ladies and gentlemen, listen carefully on this. This applies to all races. City council, state house rep, state senate. When you look at the ballot, make sure that the candidate, he or she, what I just said, is not linked to any special money or PAC. Trust me on this. President. Because you have a president of the United States right now that proved it can be done. Think about it. $46 million, right, Corey, from the time from June 2015 to the primary, $46 million, right? $46 million, what they said is that lean. We're running a lean campaign. We're cash flowing. Our bills are paid. I don't owe anyone. All my vendors are paid. We run a tight ship. That is true, Corey. That's the same way I run my business, because I got my wife. That's when I'm in trouble. No, Sharon is the backbone of everything I've ever done. And I pretty appreciate you, honey. I love you. But it's true. We got to get special interests out of the voting election. We got to get rid of it. We got to hold that accountable. I don't know where God's taking me on this journey. We'll see. I feel in my heart I can do this. I know I can do it. I'm battle tested. Lord knows we're battle tested, aren't we, Mark? You know, just get on national TV and then right. It's so funny when I just come off like CNN or MSNBC. I would literally time and take steps from the time my Twitter would blow up being called names. And I got to like 10, 14 seconds one time. And it's just boom, 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 boom. I don't want to change the names, but. It humbled me, but it also, it tested me. If you can handle this, like God says, you know, the secret of success is like, if I can trust you with this over here, then I know I can trust you with this over here. You know, Corey, God's like, I'm going to trust you to get President Trump to the primary. And then he's got something else for Corey. Think about it. You ran the baton, he handed it off. All right, y'all got this? I didn't want to go. Don't go, Corey. But that's how it is, though. That's how it is for me, in my spirit, in my heart.
And, you know, the other part of this is why I'm running, and I promise I won't be long-winded because I know y'all got to go tuck your kids in bed and tuck mom in bed, right, Bubba? We'll tuck Lauren in, right? Is that my wife and I were victims of government overreach. And what Corey said about government overreach, this happened. Some of us remember back in 08 and 09 when the TARP, y'all remember the TARP money? The taxpayers' money that were given to banks, and then FDIC took it and gave it to another bank. Well, we invested in the life savings in one of our buildings. And we were in great standings, did what we were supposed to do, got the appraisal, did the down payment, did the financials, you know, blah, 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 blah. And then another bank acquired it. And then this bank acquired it, it failed. So when this bank failed, I got a call. I'll never forget that banker. I said, Mr. LeVell, it's so nice knowing you, but we're being escorted out by the FDIC. They seized us. I'm like, whoa, okay, well, I'm paying you on time. So they took the asset, the FDIC, and I won't say the name, honey. She said, don't mention the bank's name. And handed it to this big, big bank, the bank that they said is too big to fall. Yeah, right. Okay. And then we get a call, from this banker I never knew. And says, Mr. Swell, I'm your new banker, and I just want to let you know that we're going to call your loan. What? $3 million? What are you going to call a loan for? Well, we don't want it on our books anymore. What do you mean you don't want it on our books anymore? You got $400,000 down payment. You got money. You got our hard-earned money in that. Well, things are different right now, and I'm sorry, we just can't, we just don't want it anymore. Now, you think about that, guys. Think about that. Some of us have similar stories in our own homes that are underwater. Some of us have friends and family or business owners that went through that. But then one of my good friends said, hey, Bruce, why don't you call your elected officials and tell them about this horrible thing you're doing? So I called a few U.S. congressmen, called senators, state house reps, state senators, banking committee chair people. Let me tell you what they said. Oh, Mr. and Mrs. LeVell, I'm sorry. There's nothing we can do as the economy. I'm sorry. If I heard that word, every time I heard sorry, I'd be a millionaire. I'm sorry. So then one of my good friends, he says, why don't you go look at their campaign coffers? Huh? Yeah, go see who's been giving them money while they're elected officials. See who's been supporting them. So I started going through their campaign. By the way, the campaign coffers are open to the public, ladies and gentlemen. Ain't that right, Dave? They're open to the public. Now, here's another thing. I would challenge all my candidates, right, of people in the race. I would disclose all mine right now. I bet you they won't. I know why they won't. When I went and looked at some of these, most, not all, most, they were tied to special interest. So they were beholden to the special interest. They weren't beholden to Bruce and Sharon LeVell. Now, I'm one of the bold people that's willing to put all my laundry, everything out to the public and tell you everything about me, what I went through. Now, you imagine that. You come to this town with $35 and you save up with your wife. You pawn your car. You hock your title to your car. You hock your credit cards. You sell your wedding silver. Remember that? You sell your wedding silver. No, I'm serious. How we started a business. And you look at her and say, you realize, honey, we are 30 days of being homeless if this doesn't work. Do you have faith in this? Of course we did. My mother taught me how to tithe and pray. So with that being said, I said to her, fast forwarding the story, if I'm ever granted by God to serve the people, I would stand in front of a Mack truck and never let that happen to you. And you. I would never let that happen to you. And the only way I can do that is I can't get on the take. And it's hard, guys. It really is. Running campaigns is hard, right, Corey? It's very hard. But at the end of the day, nobody owns me. See? There's no back door. Bruce, you get in. We need this. We'll try to pass a bill to get this and this kickback or this junket and these hidden LLCs overseas and the Cayman Islands that some of these guys have. Oh, no, I know. Oh, yeah. Because I'm angry. It just didn't happen to me and Sharon, it happened to millions of America. That's what put Donald Trump in office. Think about it, guys. And my challenge to everyone in here, yeah, I want to win. But I also want you to challenge some of your neighbors and your friends to run on those standards where nobody owns you, where you don't have to worry about owing somebody because they took their money. That's power. It's also power to the conscience to look your wife in the eyes, your children, your friends, and know that you didn't sell out. That's peace for me, I don't know about you guys. And it's carried us all through the storms in our family, in our business, our marriage, 25 years, February 14th, Valentine's Day. I want to be like my best friend, J.C. White, here at GB, right here. And Mr. Clark, his beautiful, significant half right there. Isn't she lovely? That's the value that I can bring. And I got many more stories because my communications guy is doing these signals telling me to shut up. Right? Just all this kind of stuff. But my heart is very pure about this, guys. And I want to do this. And, you know, I look at the president as a friend, Corey's a friend. You know, it's a journey, it's a battle, it's a war. It's a flat-out war. And I want a lot of Bruce LeVells, more across the country, to step up, serve these seats. And don't get on the take. Just do what's right. Do what's right. This is what's bleeding. It's not a Democrat situation. It's a Democrat and Republican situation. That's what the president's going through right now, guys. That health care bill, 124-page doc. I read it twice. You believe that? I read it. I did. Dr. Price wrote that he went with other doctors and they got together with healthcare workers. They put this together. Was it the greatest? Probably not. But it was a start. But guess what happened? PACs got involved and special interest caucuses got involved and it died. We cut our nose off and spied our face. That's what we did. And the reason why we couldn't get it done, because the folks who are elected in the offices are still beholden. So what are you going to do? That's what the swamp means, guys. That's where the drain swamp comes from. Think about it. Can I get amen? But anyway, I just want to close on this. I want to thank the campaign team, Joe and Dan Weissman. Thank Channel 46, Mike, for coming out. Hey, Mike. I love your red tie. A special thanks to Corey. You know, it means a lot when someone comes down here and puts their name on you. It means a lot. I'm really choking up over there when he was talking. I'm still very choked up because, you know, when you put your name on someone, it's what's the word when we tell the pastors at that meeting of Trump Towers, we said, look, once we get on that elevator, there's no turning back. You remember that, Pastor? Woo! Oh, Jesus. I don't even remember that. But that means a lot to me. And I'm going to tell you something. And everybody knows that Bruce LeVell, by Corey doing this, y'all know how I am. I'm with him forever. Y'all know that, no matter what happens. That's something about me, my character, that a lot of y'all know about me. Been looking at him, talking to him. I talk to him every day. I feel like, Pastor Burns, I appreciate you coming out all the way from South Carolina. The Mayor Mike Davis, right here. Incredible. Uncle Joe, moving kind of slow over there. Sharon, this beautiful bride right here. Telfar County, all the way from Telfar County. Sharon. Beautiful bride, you're awesome. Lisa Colley and her friends here. She's a, oh my God. And JC, I know you might be calling you out, but JC is a very dear friend of mine. You know, I could call JC and pretty much talk to him about anything. And when I say this respectfully. You gotta have younger friends, and you have to have elder friends. And JC is one of my elder friends. GB is one of my younger friends. No, seriously, JC is a very wise man, very wise. He emails me a lot of great, he thinks I don't see it because you don't have ADHD, but I actually read it, believe it or not. You know, and I'm truly thankful for JC. And Mr. Clark, you've just been there. You're like a rock, man. I get speechless about the things you supported me with, and I really appreciate you very much. And Vivian, you're the rock. You call and we pray. And Vivian Child's back there. And really, Rodney, the photographer right there. Rodney, say hello. Gene Calloway, right here. Gene, say hello, Gene. Who keeps us safe. Keep the security detail, Warville in the house, where you at? Jonathan over here, Jonathan Hulston, he's a great guy right here. Aspiring attorney right here. Where's Ellen Deal right here? Ellen Deal right here, the rock. Keeps everybody organized. Now, where's Whitney? Whitney Houston, where you at? Whitney, not you. Whitney, hi Whitney. Thanks, Whitney. She's beautiful too. Terry Harlan, the DJ, we go back, of course. Debbie, woo, you're awesome. It's like a battle. It's like a jungle. Sometimes I wonder how I keep from going under.
But we fought many battles.
That's right, we
did. Won.
Many more. Yeah. And did I forget anyone else? Mr. Yarrington, right here. Awesome. Definitely. I just thanking everybody. I'm just going through the list. I really appreciate it. So anyway, like Corey says, if you have friends, tell them about us. Yes, we'll take your money, of course. You know, and I'm thankful for everyone giving to, by the way. I'm truly blessed. And it's LeVellForCongress.com. And what I want to do, if you don't mind, we're going to get out here in a second. I'm going to go. We got to get some photos. Can everyone take? Y'all want to pass those out real quick? Go fast, real fast. We got to hold one up. And hurry up, guys. Hurry up. Look like all 80. Hurry up. Oh, like slow motion. Where's Rodney at? Yeah, he's getting some photos.
No, I just wanted the picture for us.
I'll be there.
She's
got a mic. charge of one. Tell us what you need.
Okay, on three, I need everyone to say Bruce. Say, Bubba, a little bit more life.
Come on, Hammond.
Try LeVell. Does that work better? Okay, now together, Bruce LeVell.
Bruce LeVell.
Okay, but with a little bit more authority here. Bruce LeVell. Bruce LeVell.
Bruce LeVell.
Bruce LeVell.
Bruce LeVell.
Woo! All right.
We're missing two people. Ellen.
Some other candidates who had smaller margins, and look where they came victorious. your main issue? It sounds like transportation.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. Like I said earlier, the number one problem in the Atlanta region is mobility. We have all, we've been blessed with all this growth in business, the largest airport in the world. We do have the worst quarter on February 25th in the United States of America. The president is going to do the $1 trillion infrastructure. So he needs a champion that can work with that president that's friendly to the White House, with the six that brings those tax dollars back to him.
Other people say, you know, he has all this power in Congress, he needs the opposite.
Well, you know, like I said earlier, at the end of the day, you know, I support his agenda, and I'm not afraid to say it. A lot of the candidates in the race are picking and choosing and slipping and sliding, but I'm very clear that I really want to help them, and I know I can be a champion for them. I know that. I've proven it.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.